This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Behind the Headlines is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
This week, the legislature moves one step closer to lifting a ban on new municipal school districts. Plus, one major company explains why it decided not to move to Memphis. These were the stories reported this week by our roundtable of journalists, Bill Dries of the Memphis Daily News, Les Smith, Fox 13 News, Amos Mackey of the Commercial Appeal, Jackson Baker of the Memphis Flyer, and hosted by Eric Barnes, publisher of the Memphis Daily News and the Nashville Ledger.
Eric Barnes, thanks for joining us. We start, Jackson, with the schools and the ongoing involvement of the state in the future of the Shelby County and municipal suburban schools, the Memphis City schools. Last week we had the Attorney General seem to put a roadblock up for the municipal schools to move forward with a referendum and the election of local school boards. This week the state stepped in and seems to be moving forward with enabling the municipal areas to form their own school district.
But everything may not be what it seems. In fact, this whole thing is beginning to appear to be an Alice in Wonderland scenario. Things get curiouser and curiouser. The Transition Planning Commission met last night, and they began by dealing with a resolution that would actually confer their okay on the idea of the municipal districts being able to start on January the 1st, which was the subject of the Attorney General's ruling. He said they couldn't. And then there's a bill that was meandering through the legislature, still is, that would allow that. But as they began debate, they realized there was another amendment, a stealth amendment by Mark Norris, who is the godhead of all these things in the legislature. And it basically was attached to an anti-bullying measure of all things, but basically it canceled out, it would cancel out the Attorney General's opinion and allow the process to go forward. So the TPC didn't realize what it was dealing with, finally, and out of several kinds of irascibility, which they eventually turned on the legislature thinking, I wish they'd quit meddling in our business, they rejected the amendment, which it seemed to have a head of steam to begin with. Meanwhile, in the legislature itself, as you indicated, the bill that would allow the earlier date for the municipal school districts did get passed from Education Subcommittee in the House to the full committee. But there were a lot of reservations, and the co-sponsor in the House, Gerald McCormick, actually said that, you know, I'm not sure they can do this thing with school property.
And let me first note that Les Smith is not with us this week. He's on assignment. But, Bill, I read one of your articles, and Mark Norris is saying, and he said to other folks, that, look, the Planning Commission here in Memphis doesn't know what it's dealing with. They don't know where the playing field is. They're supposed to plan for, and we've heard people on the Planning Commission say this, they're supposed to plan for a unified, consolidated school district, but meanwhile, all these moves are underway to take a bunch of the school district out. And Norris says, I think, to summarize, it's only fair to the Planning Commission that they understand what they're planning for. Is it an all-encompassing school district, or is it not?
Yeah, that's certainly the pitch that he's made to the legislature, which is composed of a lot of people who aren't from Memphis and Shelby County and who in many cases wish that they didn't have to deal with this either last year or this year. But the real discussion here is not about planning a school district without the suburban municipalities. The TPC has already said, after meeting with the suburban mayors, that they are going to work on planning for a school system that assumes that those children in the suburbs will be part of a unified school district. The other point on this is that it's not about the TPC having information to plan with. This is about timing. Do you have a countywide school system and municipal school districts start in the same school year, or do you have the unified school system start a year ahead of the municipal school district?
Which opens the possibility that the consolidated school district would open, then a year later or so, the municipal school districts would peel out, and you'd have a tremendous tumult. I mean, you've got tumult no matter what, but again, the people who would like to see some bills move to the legislature, and if it's going to happen, if the municipal school districts are going to happen, let's get it done sooner than later.
Right.
And let's go to some tape from the legislators discussing the bill up in Nashville.
I think the position we're in today, since this is the last meeting, that discussion may happen at the next level. In fact, if it doesn't happen at the next level, I'm not voting for something that I don't understand all the ramifications.
And they have been denied a right to vote twice by litigation and lawsuits. This would allow them the opportunity to vote on whether or not they want their own school systems.
And so that Jackson, some of we see some of the differences of opinion up in Nashville. I guess it's still not a slam dunk that Nashville is going to enable this to happen. As powerful as Mark Norris is, and he's very powerful, there's a lot of reservations across the state about opening the door to these municipal school districts.
Well, some of the differences of opinion, as we just saw, are happening within the Republican Party. Unlike last year when Norris Todd went through with a lockstep unity by the Republicans, Bill Dunn, the Republican you just saw from Knoxville, has great reservations about this bill. And as I said, Gerald McCormick, the actual co-sponsor in the House, has some reservations. This is because this bill now affects not just Shelby County, the entire state. And everybody up there is beginning to think, how does this affect me and my district, my schools?
Right.
So it's going to have a full debate next week.
Right.
Or it may be rolled to the following week, actually.
Right. Well, and the legislature's got about another month, and then they're trying to close down. So something will happen, we think, within the next month. We talk about reservations, and let me move to the preliminary, and I want to emphasize they are preliminary results of a poll done for the Planning Commission, the Consolidated Planning Commission, that found that while there's certainly support for the municipal school districts out in the suburbs, it's maybe not, from my point of view, as strong as I would have thought. And particularly on the issue of taxes. We've got that 30% of the people in the municipal, the suburbs, saying they don't want to pay any taxes, any extra taxes for the school district. You've got 20% saying they'd pay whatever it takes. And you've got 46% saying they would pay $50 or more in taxes. Bill, what that says is, you hear a lot. You've been at most of the rallies and the meetings and the real advocates for breaking off into suburban school districts. They feel strongly, they are loud, and I don't mean that in a bad way, but and they are saying, in these rallies, we'll pay whatever it takes to break off from the school system. In the survey, again, preliminary results, only 20% are saying we're willing to pay whatever it takes.
Right. It suggests that there is a lot of support for the municipal schools movement, but I think the poll also has the caveat that support is very nuanced. This is not as simple as gathering a bunch of people together for a meeting and saying, yeah, let's form our own school district. We live in recessionary times. And that is, and I think anyone who's a realist about this has always conceded that there is a limit to how much people can be asked to tax themselves to support.
Well, and I've made the point, and editorializing for a second, my own sense of it is people move to the suburbs for lots of reasons, but some of the big reasons are the schools, a perception or reality that schools are better, but it's also for the lower taxes, much lower taxes in the suburbs than there is in the city. And so you're going to, at some point, those people who are out in the suburbs who move there for the lower taxes, not all of them, Jackson, want to pay more in taxes for the school.
Yeah, it's a case of can you have your cake and eat it too? And Norris, as I indicated last week, is now leaning to the idea of allowing there to be an umbrella organization containing all the schools, but it must begin with actual school districts for the suburbs. That is his way of having the cake and eating it too. And that's what he's trying to do.
Right. And while we wrap this up, let me also point in the full results, I think, will be out in the next week or two, and we'll certainly come back to these. But it was interesting, the whole perception that, if the consolidated schools, the suburban schools are joined with the Memphis schools, everything's going to decline. Clearly, the survey showed that people felt that, but, and this number to me was a little surprising, only 59% of the people in the suburbs thought their schools would decline. That you would have thought from the way maybe we've covered it, the way that the whole issue's been covered, you would have thought maybe 90% thought their schools would decline. So a somewhat lower number than maybe expected. But again, we'll come back to those results and when they are fully released. We move on, Amos, to crime, an issue that is, we talk about city and county. That's one of the big ones. It's one of the ones people at least have a perception of crime in Memphis, and so they move to the suburbs. There's a group called Operation Safe Community, or an initiative, maybe I should say, that is touting some numbers that over the last 5-6 years, crime in Shelby County and in Memphis is down, and in some cases down pretty considerably.
Right. Major violent crimes down around 23%, major property crimes down around 25% over a five-year period. This has started about 6 years ago. Violent crime was a major, major, major problem. It was driving residents out. It was driving businesses away. So you had politicians, civic leaders, civic-minded folks, business leaders come together and create this strategy, Operation Safe Community. One of the main tenets of that was data-driven policing. You can do more with less, essentially, with data-driven policing. It tells you where the high crime areas are, so you deploy your resources there. Now, these drops in crime also mirror a nationwide drop in major violent crimes, and we've seen this over the decades, these cycles, researchers have. So it's a little unclear what impact all of these policies really had on crime. A lot of it depends on where you live, too. If you live in some of the poorest, most depressed areas of Memphis, I guarantee you don't feel like crime is down.
Right.
If you live where I live, in East Memphis, Sea Isle Colonial Acres area, everyone there feels that crime is down. I think the vast majority of people do have a sense that crime is down. I mean, I remember years of massive meetings at city council about relaxing the residency rules for police, you know, in order to hire more police officers. Hundreds of people showing up down there to lobby for that. I just don't get that feeling much anymore. I don't get the calls. I don't see the people showing up at City Hall like they used to. The numbers that they presented are good. We'll see if they stand up, you know, under scrutiny, but there's a definite feeling, I think, for most people that crime is down.
And we've got, you know, over the 6 year, or the, from 2006 to the end of 2011, you know, one of the ones that really stands out is, you know, 50% in motor vehicle theft down. You talked about the national trends. Year over year, 2010 to 2011, the murder rate was up some 30%. And I saw an article that actually was a nationwide trend, that most major cities saw their murder rate go up last year. There's always a question, Bill, about the numbers. You know, there've been some reporting on maybe some underreporting. How much distrust is there of these numbers? You hear about in other city scandals where, you know, the police director has you know, buried police reports because they wanted to show a declining rate. How much do we trust these numbers here in Memphis?
I think there's always a healthy distrust of the numbers. What's been different about Operation Safe Community is that the leaders who have been involved in this coordinated effort have not come out and said, well, we licked crime. We stopped it. That they've been much more nuanced about it and saying it's down. We understand that someone who's had a gun put in their face and their wallet taken or their car taken is not going to agree that crime is down. We understand that. And they've continually said there's room for more improvement. The significance of the numbers is that this six-year period begins with the time before Operation Blue Crush began. That's the targeted approach to crime hotspots that Amos talked about. That's what we've built on here, and you have a specific police philosophy, a specific change in direction in the police department that coincides with this statistical period.
Well, and we're coming up on 1 year. Tony Armstrong, the new police director, came in with some controversy and some unsettledness among the troops. We'll in the next couple of weeks, we'll come and take a look at his first year in, and also Amy Weirich, the district attorney. Those are probably the two key roles in crime fighting. She is about a year in since Bill Gibbons moved on. She's up for election. So we'll come back in the coming weeks to look at those two folks and what they've been doing. We move on back to the legislature, Jackson. And besides schools, we get pretty focused on that, understandably here. But a lot more has been going on up at the legislature. As I mentioned earlier, we're about a month from their target to end. They've gotten pretty disciplined over the last few years about ending on time. Where are we? Just start where you want with some of the highlights of the legislature.
Well, there's been some attention, as there always is, to bills having to do with abortion. There's some attention to a bill by an East Tennessee religious broadcaster who is now a member of the House of Representatives, Matthew Hill, who's been inveighing against the irresponsible patrons of the culture of death, I guess, responsible patrons of the culture of death, that he thinks are trying to impose an abortion on people. He had a bill that would officially publicize the names of all doctors providing abortions, when they were provided, the names of the patients and so forth. All that got taken out of his bill, and believe it or not, that bill was made kind of wholesome. All it does is require that physicians providing abortions must have licensing privileges at local hospitals.
It's actually it's physician privileges, and there's still some controversy behind that, that it is a smaller roadblock than the public.
And it's passed the House.
But it is merely the critics of the bill will say it's merely an attempt to make it more difficult, that there's all kinds of surgery that doctors do at hospitals without those privileges. They're certainly licensed doctors, but they don't have the formal privileges at that hospital. And critics have pointed out, why are we making doctors specifically doing abortions do that? But that's where that's moving. Let's move on to some of the other ones.
Well, we've talked about the bill that would permit guns to be in locked cars and parking lots of businesses and so forth. That bill with some modifications was finally passed by Senate Judiciary. He's headed for a Senate vote. Lieutenant Governor Ramsey had some reservations about it, but apparently those have been resolved. Basically, anyone with a hunting license or a carry permit can do this, leave a gun in a parked, locked car on business premises. There may be some problems as this bill goes to the full Senate, but it's on its way.
I saw a note in the Tennessee Journal. I should mention that the Tennessee Journal, which you are a contributor to, is a great publication for anyone who follows the state, and they do the best inside baseball coverage of the legislature. Oh, yeah. The Tennessee Journal talked a week ago about the NRA being unhappy with that compromise and what could happen if even a compromise bill that allowed some guns in cars and say an employee, a FedEx parking lot and so on, employer's parking lot, because it didn't go far enough, they would view that as a black mark, and no legislature wants a black mark from the NRA, so the bill may die. And it was an interesting point that even though it expanded those rights, it didn't go far enough, so the legislature may end up killing it.
Well, and a lot of businesses are still, very important businesses are still opposed to it also.
Right, right.
There have been various bills introduced to repeal or modify the photo ID requirement. Most of those bills have been passed off to this or that committee where they will perish. They're not going anywhere. There is the medical marijuana bill, which is getting to be a perennial, presented by Jenny Richardson of Shelby County in the House. It's actually passed subcommittee. It's on its way to a full committee vote. The prospects are probably not good, but it's being, that subject year by year is treated more seriously. Eventually, something like that will pass.
And I did know, we did some coverage of the governor's State of the State address and some of the bills that he was really pushing. One was that a change in the way that class sizes would work across the state. I noticed that had been completely dropped. A lot of opposition left and right to that sort of bill. The repeal of the inheritance tax, which was a major priority for the governor, that is moving forward through House committee, that would basically phase out the inheritance tax
in four or five years.
Okay, I think they're still talking through that.
Leaving a $90 million hole in
right.
the budget.
Okay. Well, we will come back again. 4 weeks left in the legislature, and we'll focus on that as they begin to wrap up. Our next story is a major employer in Memphis. I believe this was 2 years ago, McKesson, Bill. Moved. We all covered it. I believe we talked about it on this show, or we've talked about the impact of it on this show. They moved across the border to DeSoto County. And they did it at the time. There was a lot of talk, but we didn't necessarily have the specifics from the company about their decision making about why McKesson was going to move this major facility, some 900 jobs across the border. Recently, one of the VPs from McKesson addressed a group here in Memphis and talked about why they made that decision.
Right. His name is Douglas Pace. He's the vice president of operations, which means that among his responsibilities, he runs McKesson's redistribution center in the Hickory Hill area. He told a group of about 50 real estate professionals, folks who sell and lease these kind of sites, that the state of Tennessee's response when his company said, we are looking for a site for our $135 million new distribution center. He said the state of Tennessee under Governor Phil Bredesen was very aggressive, that they came with an offer and they were very responsive. He said when the part of this got to the city of Memphis, things went to a slow walk from there. He was very critical of the city's process. This is a distribution center that employs over 800 people. The $135 million plant that's going to open this fall in Olive Branch is the largest capital expenditure in McKesson's history. And he was very critical of the city, saying that he, as part of their pitch to Memphis officials in seeking tax breaks, they did a $45,000 diversity study.
That, in his words, ended up just sitting
just
on the shelf and nothing,
sat
and
on
nothing
the shelf
happened.
And by comparison, they didn't have to pay that money in Mississippi.
Right. And this is the kind of thing that led the city, I believe, Amos, to streamline their whole economic development group. They put under the edge group. Now, you're already laughing at me, but I'm going to go ahead. That they got rid of a whole lot of what they said were, that Luttrell and Wharton said were a whole lot of hoops and a whole lot of difficult bureaucratic process, that they streamlined that after McKesson and after other people like McKesson had complained about the city of Memphis's labyrinth of rules and regulations to get incentives. And since McKesson, the city has gotten a bunch of big wins on economic development. Now I'm going to let you talk, because you're already...
Before
Edge
was formed.
Yes.
I mean, what they did was just reshuffle the decks. You still have to go before a board and get approval for a pilot, our main incentive tool. There's virtually no difference. Instead of going to the industrial development board, you go to the Edge board and get your tax break. Now, where there is a difference, I think, is a ton of cooperation between the two mayors, Wharton and Luttrell, and the Memphis Chamber. And I think the two mayors have made it known inside the county building, inside City Hall, that we want businesses here. You do whatever it takes. You cut this tape. You make this your top priority. And that's why we've seen the wins, Mitsubishi, Electrolux, Kruger. It starts from the top. You let the bureaucracy know that this is one of our top priorities. You hammer that message home, and then you have, you know, you don't have people from the city recruiting businesses. We don't have anybody who does that. Charles Galata, the head of
most of that falls to the chamber, who does the recruiting, and then they bring the packages to the city and county,
and then they get beat up by legislators who don't like the chamber for some reason.
Right, but it is an interesting point. Regardless, I mean, I would probably differ with you that the Edge board is just a shuffling of the deck. I do think they're streamlining, and Wharton himself, maybe on the show, he certainly said to me that when he walked in to the city of Memphis, their economic development efforts was a mess. There's too much red tape and so on. But let me say this, that the what he talked about, the guy from McKesson, I've just forgotten his name, he laid out a thing we've talked about on this show and debated the worth of, say, the Electrolux incentives. And you get city council people, county commissioners saying these are too, we're giving too much money away. He really did lay it out that that's the game. Mm-hmm. You can say you're not going to put those incentives out there, and that's a perfectly rational point of view, but you're going to lose the $135 million investment. You're going to lose the 900 existing jobs, let alone the new jobs that come in with some of these. And that's what he said.
Right, and to punctuate the point, to make the point clear, he said that for every Memphis employee who works now in Hickory Hill is going to be offered a job in that plant in Olive Branch, Mississippi. Not only that, any employee from the Memphis plant who goes to Olive Branch in the move, McKesson is going to pay their Mississippi state income tax in perpetuity until they retire from their job there.
And it's an amazing statement that it was still worth it to pay all those taxes, and companies don't like to pay taxes usually, and still it was worth it to move down to DeSoto County. All right, we move on to the sidebar, and we'll start with you, Jackson. And there was an anti-cruelty ordinance that came up in the county commission that has been proposed, I believe, originally by Steve Mulroy. What's the update?
Well, it's been knocking around for months. It's been amended back and forth several times. And essentially, it fell into that chasm between separating city and county interests, because a lot of people representing the suburban unincorporated areas have objected to that ordinance on the grounds that it imposes too much control. And the Tea Party people have had people there at every meeting opposing it. Eventually, Brent Taylor said, well, why don't we shelve it indefinitely? And essentially, that's what happened. So it's gone.
Is Mulroy, I mean, does he bring back next session? What's his next move, or do you have any sense?
Well, no time soon. He realizes it's over for this year, and by the nature of the resolution they passed, it's over for this year.
Okay, let's go to some sound of the commission talking about this issue.
All this googly gop about men and women and dogs being on the same level, that is not kosher with me. And you know, it borders on dog idolatry and blasphemy.
Who saw the movie Old Yeller? He was a trusty old friend who went out there and said, and got our slippers and licked us on the face, and we loved that dog, but when it came time to, when he got a little bit sick, we shot him in the head. We don't treat animals the same way we treat human beings.
It's amazing how much, I'm sorry, I stepped on you. It's amazing the emotions. I mean, I can almost snicker a little bit, okay, what those folks are saying, but the emotions that these kind of issues bring out, and it goes to sort of the issues around the animal shelter in Memphis. I mean, where there was obviously some horrible things happening, but people have real expectations for how we treat animals that sometimes are hard to meet.
That first gentleman you saw, Lee Cochran, talked about the blasphemy of it all and having all this googly talk. He's been at every meeting and this has been discussed. He stays for the whole time, and he represents that whole Tea Party contingent that has been there every time.
All right, let's do real quickly the Pettus trial, your whole life for the last month or two or three, Bill. We got some information this week. You got 10 seconds, 15 seconds.
We had verdicts last week. Martin Lewis and Clinton Lewis found guilty on all of the counts except for one kidnapping count in the case of Clinton Lewis. Both of these men face probably life in prison once we have sentencing this summer.
All right. Well, we leave it there. Thank you for joining us. Please join us again next week. Thanks and good night.